In this video, we're solving a classic static equilibrium problem that we might call the slipping ladder problem. So we're given a ladder with a length of L and a given mass of M sub L, and this is leaning up against a smooth wall, meaning there's no friction at the contact point with the wall, and that's happening at a fixed angle of theta. Now the contact with the floor does have friction. That's what holds the ladder in place, so we're given just a general static friction coefficient there. And then we have a person with a given mass of m sub p walking up the ladder. They're currently a distance of x from the bottom edge of the ladder. And then the whole point of the problem is to figure out how far can this person go up the ladder before it breaks loose and starts to slip. So as we set up the problem, we end up with a really complicated force diagram. So I'm just gonna zoom in on the picture here to give us as much room as we can possibly get. And that is the way to start the problem. We need to just label all the forces that are acting on this ladder. So I'm gonna eyeball the center of mass of the ladder because that's where gravity acts on the ladder itself. So there's gravity pulling down on the center of mass of the ladder with a magnitude of m sub L times g. Next, we need to think about the force on the ladder exerted by the person. And we're just gonna kind of ballpark the person's center of mass here. That's really what we mean by x is the distance of the average location of the force exerted by the person relative to the bottom edge of the ladder. So the force the person is exerting down on the ladder is equal to the weight of the person. And that weight is m sub p times g. Now the ladder is leaning up against a smooth wall. And that word smooth means literally frictionless as an approximation. So the wall can only exert a normal force. Let's go ahead and get that into the diagram. And we're going to call that N sub W for the normal force exerted by the wall, because we need to distinguish between two different normal forces in this problem. At the contact point with the floor, we have a normal force exerted by the floor pointing straight upward. All right, and we're going to call that one, of course, N sub F for the normal force exerted by the floor. Now finally, we have a friction force exerted at that contact point with the floor, and we have to do some force reasoning to just figure out which way that points. I notice there's only one other horizontal force in the problem. That's the normal force exerted by the wall pushing to the left on the ladder. That means the friction force must be pushing to the right in order to hold the ladder in place. And I went ahead and put some details in about the friction force. When we're trying to find the breakaway point for a system, that means the static friction force is maxed out, and that means it can be expressed as mu s, the static friction coefficient, times the normal force at that contact point. All right, now the next thing I want to do is just make an argument for why there should be a breakaway point as you go higher and higher up the ladder. Like, why is it more likely to slip the higher you go up the ladder? And to get some clarity on this, we think about the rotation axis as the contact point with the floor. And in order to keep this thing in static equilibrium, the clockwise torques have to be equal to the counterclockwise torques. Well, what happens as the person goes higher and higher up the ladder is they're increasing their lever arm with respect to that rotation axis. That means there's a bigger clockwise torque on the ladder. Now that requires the normal force exerted by the wall to get bigger in order to create a bigger counterclockwise torque. And if the normal force of the wall pushing to the left on the ladder is getting bigger, that requires the static friction force pushing to the right to get bigger. So the higher this person goes, the bigger the static friction force gets until we eventually get to a breakaway point where the static friction force is maximized, and that's what we're looking for. Now this is a nice force diagram, but unfortunately, we have to compute all the torques that are exerted by the weight of the ladder, the weight of the person, the normal force exerted by the wall, and that's relative to this same chosen rotation axis, that's the contact point with the floor. Well, since we have to compute torques, that means we need to get perpendicular components of all of these force vectors. So we've sketched in some dotted perpendiculars to the ladder. And the first thing we want to do is use the fact that the angle between the vertical and the perpendicular for an incline is the same as the angle of incline itself. And I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived, but you're probably familiar with doing this. Most commonly with breaking the force of gravity into parallel and perpendicular pieces for an inclined plane problem. Well, all we're concerned about here is the perpendicular piece. So for the weight of the ladder itself, that perpendicular piece is given by the adjacent side to this angle, which is the same as the angle of incline. And so for that component, we get an m sub L times g cosine of theta. Now a similar thing is going to happen with the perpendicular component of the person's weight. And that's given by m sub p times g times the cosine of theta. Now we need to get the perpendicular component of the normal force exerted by the wall. And for this, we have to recognize two alternate interior angles. So the angle of incline down here is an alternate interior angle with the angle between that normal force and the ladder itself. Well, this means the perpendicular component of n sub w is given by n sub w times the sine of theta. Okay, so that's turned into a pretty complicated force diagram, but with all of these perpendicular components computed, things are going to come together pretty fast. To analyze any equilibrium problem, what we're saying is all the torques must balance relative to any rotation axis that we choose, all the x forces must balance, and all the y forces must balance. So I'm going to start with the torque analysis. So we're saying the sum of all the torques is equal to zero. Technically, that's a vector equation, just meaning clockwise and counterclockwise torques have opposite signs. And this is totally equivalent to saying the total clockwise torque is equal to the total counterclockwise torque. So we start adding up all the clockwise torques with respect to this contact point with the floor, which we've chosen as our rotation axis. And I've got the weight of the ladder itself acting at the center of mass of the ladder. And we already figured out the perpendicular component of that is mlg cosine theta. And then the lever arm there is the distance to the rotation axis, which is half the length of the ladder, or big L over 2. Now for the weight of the person, the perpendicular component of that weight vector is m sub p g times cosine theta, and the lever arm is x. That's actually what we're trying to solve for in this problem. And then our only counterclockwise torque is caused by this component of the normal force exerted by the wall, so that's n sub w times the sine of theta, and the lever arm there is L. So there's our torque equation, and now we can look at the force equations. So if I look at the sum of all the forces in the x direction, again, technically a vector equation, but informally we just say all the forces acting to the right must be balanced by the forces acting to the left. And that's really quick. The only force acting to the right is the static friction force at the floor, so that's mu s times this unknown normal force exerted by the floor. And the only force acting to the left is the normal force exerted by the wall pointing directly to the left. So finally, we look at all the forces in the y direction. Again, technically a vector equation, but all we have to say is all the forces upward better be equal to all the forces downward. There's only one force pointing upward. That's the normal force exerted by the floor. And then two forces pointing downward. It's the sum of the two weights, the weight of the ladder and the weight of the person. And we might as well do a little factoring while we're working on this. It's just the total weight of the ladder plus the person, so we're just going to add their masses together and take that and multiply it by g. That's our total downward force. All right, so now we have to start working with this system of equations, and again, the goal is to solve for x, and we actually have three unknowns here. It's x and the two unknown normal forces. The rest of the variables that are in here are things that we want to express x in terms of. So the first thing I do is realize that nf can be eliminated from the system by simply subbing that third equation into the second one. So this gives us mu s times ml plus mp times g is equal to n sub w, the normal force exerted by the wall. Now this is also quickly eliminated by using a substitution method. I just take this nw and replace it in the torque equation. And we've immediately arrived at a single equation with our unknown x in it. And after that, we just have to algebraically isolate x. So we just copy down the left side of this first equation, and then we replace nw with this expression right above. And then I have a sine theta times L left over on the right-hand side. And there's a single equation for our single unknown. Now things are going to start cleaning up here. I can cancel a g out. So this maximum height is not dependent on the strength of gravity. And to clean things up, I'm also going to divide by the cosine of theta on both sides. Notice that gets rid of the cosine theta in the first term and the second term on the left. And it transforms the sine of theta into sine over cosine, which is tangent. So now I have ml times L over 2 plus mpx is equal to mu s times the sum of the two masses, ml plus mp, times tangent theta times L. Now we just have to subtract this first term on the left, and we're getting really close to isolating x. We have np times x. And I notice that each term that ends up on the right after we do this subtraction has an l in it, so I'm going to go ahead and factor that out. So I get an l. So we'll just copy down this first term on the right-hand side without the l in it because we factored it out. So that's mu s ml plus np times the tangent of theta. And then we're subtracting this term from the left, but we factored an l out of it. So we end up with a minus ml over 2. All that's left to do now is divide both sides by np, and we'll have x. That's the general solution to the slipping ladder problem, the maximum distance the person can go up the ladder before it begins to slip. So I'm going to actually move the np inside the parentheses for a good reason that I'll explain in just a second. And this gives me a term that looks like this in my first piece. It's ml plus np divided by np times the tangent theta. And then in my second piece, ml over 2mp. Now we're going to keep that as our final answer. And the reason I arranged it this way was it gives me a way of checking my work by making sure the units make sense. So if I look in these parentheses, there's something really special about this expression. It's completely unitless. I have a coefficient of friction, which is a unitless quantity. I have a ratio of two masses, which is unitless, a tangent of theta, which is unitless. And then in the second term, another ratio of two masses, again, unitless. So the entire thing in parentheses has no units. The only thing with units on the right-hand side is big L, the length of the ladder, which has units of meters. And that's what we should get when we solve for this maximum distance, x. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.